Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mochaki Masipa. I'm the Dean of Students of the University of Limpopo in South Africa. I'm here with Mabore Malahlela, who is assisting in my office. Today we're here to come and share our paper on modeling the cultivation of future leaders through student leadership engagement. Layout of our paper today, we'll start with introduction. We will then go to purpose. We'll talk about the methodology that we used. And we'll go into discussions, and then we'll provide a conclusion of our paper. The background, student leadership structures in South African higher education institutions are legislated. The Act provides for the establishment of such structures in a form of student representative council. This implies that university statutes are compelled to recognize the SRC as a governing structure of the university. Each institution has a responsibility to develop an SRC constitution as a guiding document for student leadership. Constitution of the SRC actually serves as its policy document. It gives the SRC its governing powers. It provides guidance of its operations. It defines the different roles of its members, and it is the embodiment of the existence of the SRC. So in other words, most of the activities that the SRC does are directly guided by the SRC constitution. Based on the guidance of the SRC, we are now going to be talking to you about the roles of the SRC. The SRC serves as the voice of students. In other words, they talk for students and they listen to students. It provides support to students. In general, information that students may need, where students have got complaints, the SRC has to give an ear and listen to the students. It supports structures reporting to the SRC. All those other structures, such as the political structures and academic structures that report to the SRC, they get information and they get support from the SRC. The SRC also contributes to policy making by initiating the development of policy relating to students. This they do by gathering information from the students and sometimes making inputs themselves to make sure that policies change and to make sure that policies are developed that are supporting students. They represent the students in university matters and important committees of the university. The SRC listens to students on matters affecting them, as I've already alluded to the issues of policy, and the SRC serves as a communication link between the university and the students. As we all know, student support services are usually not documented or written anywhere, and this makes it very difficult for anybody to establish such services when you have to start from scratch. The creation of support environment is based on experience accumulated over a period of time. It is therefore necessary that practices be recorded to guide newly established institutions. Student leadership development is one such area that requires sharing of information, not only at initial stages, but also for further development and improvement. So we can learn from each other once we have information that is documented. Exposure of one program can also be used to initiate discussions to serve as a monitoring strategy for those that are advanced in the area. That is one of the reasons why the discussion here, so that if there's anybody that knows better about this, those people can advise and say, this is where areas of improvement can come in. Exposure of the services to scrutiny in particular will also contribute to the improvement of programs. We all know different institutions of higher learning use different models to constitute the SRC. This paper shed light on the effectiveness of the unitary model of student leadership as a catalyst to develop future leaders. In the next slides that are going to follow, you will see how we explain the model and how that model can be used effectively. We will also indicate the challenges that a person can encounter when that model is being used. In the unitary model of governance, the SRC is central to all structures of student leadership. And as it has been stated, its existence and operations are guided by the SRC Constitution. In such models, the composition of the SRC is done through elections of candidates submitted by different structures and sometimes independent candidates. The SRC elections are usually run by external scrutineers for objectivity, guided by the SRC Constitution. All structures that are affiliated for a certain period of time, as stated in the Constitution, will then be eligible for participation. Recently, the elections of the SRC are conducted electronically in most of the institutions. And then later on, then there would be representatives of faculties also elected with the SRC, but separately. In some of the institutions, thereafter, there are elections that are conducted for school councils. Unitary model, we usually have the executive committee of the SRC. The president, the deputy president, the secretary general, the deputy secretary general, and the treasurer are those that are basic positions that you'll find in each of the model. In some institutions, you might find that they've got more than one deputy president and so on. But these five positions are the basic positions of this particular model. We then have the faculty representatives. And these faculty representatives are responsible, each one of them, for each faculty. The election of the faculty representatives is run slightly different from the central SRC in that only the people that are in that particular faculty elect their faculty representative. The faculty representatives are responsible for school councils, which are elected separately in some of the universities. The chairpersons of portfolios, such as student residences, the safety portfolio, the portfolio of disability, are also elected together with the central SRC. As I have already indicated that the different structures submit the names for elections, I just wanted to indicate that different universities have different structures, such as the political structures, which are mainly used in most of the universities for purposes of electing members of the SRC. And then therefore we still have academic structures, social structures, religious structures, and so on. It is very important to note that the model that we are talking about is basically a replica of the model of elections that are taking place in the country.
As I've been introduced before, my name is Mabore Jacobeth Malahlela, and I am the co-presenter for this paper. Now, allow me to take you through some of the discussions that we have in this presentation. And that includes the training and development programs that are offered to the different groups within the student leadership structures, where the SRC is offered special programs as the central body to prepare and train them to be able to assist students, and where structures are also taken through some of the training and development, where they're taken through selected projects for financial skills, leadership skills, and they're also taken through constitutional orientation to be able to lead the different structures. And as some of the services given to students by the SRC, The student body is sometimes engaged in training programs such as financial management, academic rules and procedures, and other skills through campaigns. So now the training programs of the SRC aim to provide SRC members with the skills that they need to manage their obligations, to speak up for and represent their fellow students, and improve the university community. Now, through a combination of formal and informal training, SRC members stand to gain a variety of education that prepares them for leadership roles within the SRC and beyond. SRC members go through two types of learning, where they go through the formal learning and the informal learning. And in the formal learning, they go through training that equips them to operate their day-to-day administration to the students and to the university community. In the leadership and management skills, these are skills that they gain through the training programs, where they are then taught how to lead within the different portfolios. And in the policy implementation, this is where they're also given an opportunity to sit in meetings in university committees, where they get advantages of contributing to policy implementation. And with management skills, this is where they are then taught how to manage their finances properly, and with the funds that are allocated to them in the different portfolios. There's also in the SRC, there's also the financial committee that consists of the executive committee, which is also then taught and taken through some of these financial management, where they gain insight on how to manage their funds properly. And with conflict resolution, which can come highly impactful in their council, where they then are taught how to manage conflicts effectively within the council. With the informal learning, this is where they have to then, this is the type of learning that is not really that structured, where they have to canvass for elections, participate in meetings in the university community, whether formal or informal meetings, where they get a chance to be able to voice out the opinions and perspectives that they get from students, and also with the planning and executing of campaigns, they also then gain different skills through managing and arranging campaigns. And that is also seen where they then arrange campaigns to the student body, where they then call them and also take them through trainings such as financial management and so on.
Like any model, the unitary model has got its own challenges. We will start with the organizational interference. This is when elections of the SRC depend on political structures in particular, whereby the external political structures interfere with the internal political structures and therefore affecting the activities of the SRC. Another challenge that we always experience is post office challenges, whereby those people that have been members of the SRC have a problem reorientating themselves into the community of students, whereby they do not have powers any longer. This is a very difficult task, and a lot of effort has to be put in to make sure that they are also fitting into the community, back into the community, where the opportunities are not there any longer for them. Some of them experience academic challenges. If SRCs are not given enough support, some of them, because of the level of engagement in their portfolios and different positions, have academic challenges, academic activities suffering. And therefore, the most important thing here is to make sure that they are being monitored, that the academic activities and performance is checked time and again, and that they've got enough support so that they do not concentrate all their efforts on matters of the SRC.
In an effort to conclude the presentation of this paper, The study underscores the significance of structured leadership experiences in higher education and how they contribute to the personal and professional development of students. By examining the activities, training programs, constitution, and the composition of the SRC, the study offers valuable insights that can benefit other universities aiming to enhance their student leadership programs. Thank you.